Welcome to History 391. Today the big question is, how did the American War in Vietnam end? Well, from the Vietnamese communist perspective, the North Vietnamese perspective, or perhaps if you want to think of it this way, the Vietnamese nationalist perspective, it ended extremely well, with the country being unified under Vietnamese control in 1975. For the Americans, it was an enormous humiliation, characterized really by the ultimate fall of Saigon in 75 and the sight of people desperately scrambling to try and get onto American helicopters. So how did the US get there? Well, in the final few years, as we talked about a couple of days ago, Richard Nixon had kind of dressed up an old strategy as something a little bit new, and certainly brought his own Nixonian flair to it. For example, illegally bombing Cambodia and things like that. And beyond that, not telling the American people about it. He's not called Tricky Dicky for nothing. Now, at the same time, although it's tempting to dunk on Nixon, and I kind of do that a lot, as pretty much everybody does, he is an interesting leader in many ways. And although perhaps it's sometimes a little bit unsettling, and I think the sources for this week kind of brought that out a little bit, just how willing Kissinger in particular was to effectively sell the South Vietnamese down the river while saying very different things in public, it's hard to know who's going to do much better. Nixon, of course, is removed in humiliation, or removes himself technically after Watergate, and leaving Ford, who's kind of this president that isn't really thought of terribly much in American history. He's kind of seen as the guy that was Nixon's VP and then he was president for a couple of years. But it comes to Ford to be the man to say, right, we're done, we're out of here.
By 1974, North Vietnamese troops had violated the Paris Peace Accords and renewed their assault on the South. It was clear the Republic of Vietnam would fall. In April of 75, North Vietnamese troops approached the southern capital of Saigon. President Gerald Ford ordered all U.S. troops and citizens out of the country.
To permit the movement of refugees to the area of their choice.
And on April 29th, Armed Forces Radio began playing White Christmas to signal an evacuation was underway.
I'm dreaming of a white Christmas.
Captain Gerald Barry was assigned to rescue U.S. Ambassador Graham Martin. The mission evolved into an 18-hour day of shuttling people to an armada of ships waiting in the South China Sea. And as Barry flew toward the U.S. Embassy in Saigon, he could see enemy tanks approaching the city.
So I land behind the embassy, said, I'm here to get the ambassador. Because I'm thinking somebody told him I was coming to get him. Well, then somebody else gets on the phone and said, well, the ambassador isn't coming. I said, well, really? I said, I'm supposed to get him. Well, no, he's not. So take a lift of these. So they loaded Vietnamese on.
In the early hours of April 30th, despite multiple flights with hundreds of evacuees and with time running out, Barry uttered three words that meant it was imperative for the U.S. diplomat to leave.
I'm not leaving the roof until the ambassador's on board. And out of nowhere, I said, the president sends. 2 minutes later, the ambassador's up with his whole staff to come out. That's all we needed. Probably needed, I could have said that at 12 in the afternoon. So he comes up, gets on, we fly out with the ambassador, and you make the call, you know, tiger, 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 that means the ambassador's out.
Personally, I'm embarrassed. I'm embarrassed that the United States of America is being humiliated and is leaving an area that we had come to defend, and we've been defeated. Yes, we've chosen to leave, but we've chosen to leave because it's no longer defendable with the resources that we have chosen to commit. And the limits that we have put on our involvement in South Vietnam.
So what's happening? Well, again, a lot of bad things are happening. The draft had been enormously unpopular, so much so that Nixon had to revise it pretty significantly. There was a feeling that the draft was sending predominantly Americans of poorer economic background, including minorities, to Vietnam more than privileged white kids. This kind of actually played into one of Nixon's big talking points, was that all the critics and the counterculture hippies and so on were a bunch of middle class or wealthy white people who were complaining and didn't actually know what they were talking about. That the average American, the silent majority, if you will, supported the war, or at least were decent people and weren't picking at things for no reason, which was, you know, largely the Nixonian position. And, you know, I think there's actually some element of truth to that, a lot of complexity around the counterculture movement. But as we'll see in the coming weeks in class, the counterculture movement successfully becomes the dominant movement, the main voice, really, in American memory of the war and the American experience. The boomer generation, as we now call them, back before it was okay boomer, they were burning bras and yelling at the Washington Memorial and generally, in their own mind at least, saving the country. But at the same time, any idea that the, you know, this was limited to a select number of obnoxious kind of wealthy, you know, Twitter users before there was Twitter type demonstrators isn't actually terribly fair at all. And America in many ways was tearing itself apart. One of the most vivid examples of this was the Kent State shooting of 1970, when four people were shot dead on the campus of Kent State University in Ohio. Again, another Neil Young song, another Neil Young reference, four dead in Ohio. You know, this sense that it was Nixon's fault and Nixon had allowed it to happen. This iconography happens a lot. The very, very famous image of the female student mourning over one of the victims, and just this iconography showing up all the time. And the sense that, you know, this isn't meant to happen in the United States. You know, this, the United States is not a country where troops open fire on their own people, regardless of the context. Kent State was a horrible moment in American history, and in many ways was kind of, has been seen, it has been discussed as the end of the 1960s and the beginning of the 1970s. I personally have always felt the 1970s was underrated. I think bell bottoms are pretty cool, but certainly geopolitically, 1970s ends up not being kind to the US. And the US begins the 1970s with clear decline in Vietnam and then finally defeat in Vietnam. Meanwhile, morale amongst American troops in Vietnam is completely imploding. It's becoming a real problem. Morale with the South Vietnamese troops was always a problem, but the American troops, it seemed, were okay. That was what the steady feed of Coca-Cola and beer and barbecues was supposed to actually do. But in practice, American troops over there were getting pretty upset. We know there were a lot of drug addicts amongst the American troops at that time, or certainly drug users. And people beginning to develop substance abuse problems. You started to have American troops coming home and perhaps not being received in the way they anticipated they might be received, although some of that stuff has been overblown, and we'll talk about that in future weeks as well. Certainly, there were major problems between enlisted men and officers. In fact, the most famous and kind of terrifying example of this was fragging, where they would use grenades to basically kill their superior officers as an act of defiance and an act of mutiny. This is where we get the word fragging, which now is used in video games all the time, but actually comes from a pretty horrendous murder of an officer by an enlisted man in 1970s Vietnam. So things were very rough, and the American government was very worried things were going to get rougher and things would get worse. And so this is all kind of dovetailing with Nixon's decision to leave. So Nixon, of course, is gone after Watergate as of 1973, shortly after an enormous electoral victory in the election of 1972, and it's left to Ford to kind of pick up the pieces. American troops are gone by 1973, but in 1975, the city of Saigon finally falls, and this is a huge moment. And in the days after Saigon has fallen, you have all these accusations against the Americans. The American military is trying to remove every American that it can from South Vietnam, as well as Vietnamese local people who would be targets of the Vietnamese communists, seen as collaborators with the Americans, and the images are terrible. As is in many ways, you know, Ford's speech. And at this point, it's gone for several years. Vietnam just sounds to American ears like defeat. Vietnam sounds to American ears like a huge mistake. There are more and more Americans who have actually been convinced or have convinced themselves that yes, the United States was an imperialist power. How did it come to this? From the Vietnamese perspective, in theory, this is the dream, right? This is the realization of a united Vietnamese nation. But what kind of a Vietnamese nation is being built? Well, a communist Vietnamese nation. There's lots of problems with this, right? They didn't really defeat a democratic alternative, because the truth is, sadly, there wasn't a democratic alternative in Vietnam. There hadn't been a democratic alternative in Vietnam. The Americans had not succeeded in fostering one. Various leaders the Americans supported turned out to have all kinds of problems. Not least of which was their lack of commitment to open democracy and open votes. The Vietnamese communists were better organized, had a better vision, were better able to sell that vision to enough people of Vietnam, and they suppressed others. And that worked. And in many ways, the domino theory, although not proven right, because the Vietnamese don't go down and start invading other countries per se, the loss of Vietnam is also a loss of Vietnam to communism. Back in the United States, this has major ongoing impacts. The counterculture effectively wins the argument. And I know I've referenced counterculture a lot. We'll get to them, I promise. We'll talk about them at fairly serious length, and we'll talk about their complaints. I want to take a week next week to talk about kind of a Vietnamese perspective of the fall of South Vietnam, and then we'll go through McNamara's reminiscences, and we'll come back around again to talk about how the American kind of public is experiencing this. But you've all grown up, I grew up, even in Ireland I grew up, with this understanding of the American experience of Vietnam as an entirely negative one, as a failure. The narrative of the counterculture very much has won the day, and it already won the day by 1975. And fairness had won for good reason. So today's discussion question, which I'm going to try and keep simple, which hopefully doesn't make it too difficult, is why does the fall of Saigon strike such a massive blow on the American psyche? Okay, thanks for watching.